It is a privilege to get a chance to preach the moderator service. Let me do the coaching at the front end so we don't stop in the middle. I love these things. In our church, we call them the McWafers. So two ends, open the bread end first. We'll take the bread. If you open the juice end before you then open the other end, you're wearing the juice. Then you rotate deliberately, remove, and take communion. And we'll do that later. And then after our communion time, we actually will have a chance. Moderators and some of their spouses and some of the people we've invited to come help us are going to line up here. And if you'd just like somebody to pray for you, you can just come on down and we'll pray. And then we'll take a short break and then we'll go right into our business session. So let's pray. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Lord, we come before you just to adore you and to say you are worthy of anything we could bring, of everything we could bring, of more than we can bring. You are worthy. And Lord Jesus, we humble ourselves before you, and it is only because your mercy and your love were so great that we all got swept up in the glory with you, and that you have carried us on your shoulders to this place, and we give you praise. Would you come and oversee every little thing that happens this day? For we are here to declare Jesus is Lord. Amen. The scripture today is out of 1 Chronicles 16. See if we can get that up on the screen for you. It's very simple. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the peoples. I've come to believe that there are two ways that you can minimize the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. One is to have too small a view of your own sin, and we are reformed, so we have a big view of our sin. Amen? The other is to have a small view of God's glory, because it's the cross that covers the gap. And if God is not very high and we're not very low, then the cross is small. But if God is holy and glorious and we are not, then the cross is amazing. It reminds us of how far God was willing to come to us and how far he was willing to carry us. So I want to talk today about declaring his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the people. Now, as people of a Reformed faith, we know that the goal of the Christian walk is to declare God's glory, solo Deo gloria, for God's glory alone, that everything is a part of that. We draw that from 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. We also know that that God declares glory in a lot of ways. In Habakkuk 2:14, he says, "The earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea." So as we gather today and we end our time going into business, I just want to talk about God's glory. How it's really solo Deo gloria, all for God. And I want us to end not focusing on what the world has to say, what the media outlets are pressing, what the results are in the Stanley Cup. I want to pause there for a second. Colorado, Stanley Cup, Avalanche. Okay, no, I don't want to talk about that. What I want to talk about is the glory of God that we have been gifted with to declare everywhere we go. It's easy for me to think that I deserve a little bit of God's glory. You know, we as humans are glory magnets, maybe glory hogs. We just like a little bit. And the Lord and I did something special. And we often say, it wasn't great what God did, but inside what we're saying is, wasn't it great kind of what we did together, Lord? And we sometimes want a little bit of God's glory, and that's true. I grew up in a family where the only attention I got was when I performed well. If I won an award or got an academic, some sort of accolade, or if I was playing sports really well, I got attention. So I learned that's what I have to do. I have to really perform well, and then I'll get attention. But the Lord has a great sense of humor. And on the day that I was to be ordained, happens that I was ordained at the same church I'm serving now, even after I served there for a while, and then I went off and served 15 years in a different church, and then I was invited to come back as the senior pastor of Cherry Creek. On the day that I got ordained, it's a big deal. You come down the aisle, you get a robe, there's a monstrous cross, you sit at the front, everybody looks at you, and the young man, I was in my 30s, was the ordinand, that's what we call them. They come in, and Cherry Creek makes a big deal of it, and right before the service, I bent over, I had a new gray suit on, and I ripped my pants. So that doesn't really explain why. I ripped it from stem to stern, from the back buckle to the front buckle. I created from a pair of pants a pair of chaps. And afterwards, I was talking to somebody, and they said, well, they must have not sewed it well. But I said, I don't know what I did. But this is right before the service. I'm supposed to parade before all of these people. And wouldn't you know, I had red, white, and blue boxer shorts on that day. So it was bad, and I was in sheer panic. This is the day where I get robed. This is the day where I'm brought into the kingdom of God. This is the day that I become the pastor, and yet I can't go in there. And thankfully, a really good friend of mine named Chuck, who is a monstrous guy, maybe 6'6 and 360 pounds, ex-FBI agent, was one of the elders. And he came to my office, and he's monstrous, and he came, Brad, it's time. I'm like, I can't do it, Chuck. I can't do it. And he said, well, what? You know, and then, of course, he just laughed. No compassion. And it was even worse because in that few minutes, I tried to staple them together so I could barely walk, because there were staples in places that staples should never be. And I said, Chuck, give me your pants. And he just laughed. He said, no, I don't think that's going to work. He said, but do you trust me? And I said, yes, Chuck. He said, okay, so just come with me. And he led me to the back of the sanctuary, and we were standing outside the doors, and the elders had all lined up, and they were already playing the organ, and I'm like, I will never live this down. And then he got behind me, and he laid his hands on my shoulders, and he pulled me in close to him, and his coat was so large that it kind of became a tent around me, and he said, walk slow. Left, right, left, right. And he walked me in a processional manner all the way down to the front, and nobody could see. They could barely see me, my head just bobbing in his coat. But nobody could see how exposed I was, how naked I was, how vulnerable, how impure, how not really pastor material I was. And it went great, except when we got to the stairs, then I thought, how is he going to do this? This is bad. And yet he said, trust me. Okay, ready? Up one step. Up the other step. And he took me up, and there was a chair that faced the congregation sitting right over here, And then I got, the blood must have drained from my face. He's like, I got to turn around and sit down in this thing, and they're all going to see me. And so he took me to the chair, and he stood in front of me, and he motioned to his wife, bring me my Bible. His wife Janine brought, now he's a big man, so his Bible is a big Bible. And with him kind of shielding me still from the rest of the group, he said, sit down, and close your legs, and he set this big Bible. And he said, do not get up till I come back. And he went down and took a seat, and we did the service. And then it was time for the robing. He came up, and with my wife, they held the robe like a curtain between me and everybody else, and they robed me. And no one knew but Chuck and me how much I needed to be covered. Anytime I go to the pulpit now, I am reminded it's not about me. Sola Deo Gloria. Lord, you had every right to embarrass me, and I don't deserve any of this, but you chose to cover me. It's become the metaphor of my whole life. It's the glory of God that covers us. When we are feeling undone, when our church has become chaps, when things are not as they should be, I want to tell you that God is sufficient. And he wraps us in his glory. And that's really what I want to end on today in our time together. The glory of God. You ever been in a really bad thunderstorm? You ever been in a storm that's so bad that you're afraid you might get hit by lightning? And you're soaked instantaneously to the skin. There's a mountain in the middle of Rocky Mountain National Park called Long's Peak, and I've climbed it a number of times. And it's one of the most dangerous places in the world in a storm, because it's perfectly flat and there's no cover. And I've been caught up there in a thunderstorm, and people die because you're the highest object in miles. You're standing up there, so you press your face into the stone. And you feel the hairs on the back of your neck tingle. Well, Psalm 29 is that experience in Scripture. I love it because David gives a psalm and he almost talks nothing about humanity. He doesn't talk really about himself. He doesn't talk about his need. Often David is very frank about his struggle and his issue. It's almost like in this psalm, I'm going to talk about God and his glory. And that's what he does. So let me go through Psalm 29 for you. It's a loud psalm. You can hear the motion of God and the thunder and the lightning. You can't really appreciate Psalm 29 if you're not a little bit in the middle of the storm. Psalm 29 at verse 1. Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. It didn't even start on earth. It starts in heaven. Probably David is watching a storm roll across Palestine, and he's overwhelmed by it, and it begins to speak to him of God's glory. And as the Holy Spirit moves in him, he starts to write down words to a song. And it starts in heaven with the holy ones ascribing to the Lord what? Glory. Glory. Ascribe to the Lord, glory to his name. Worship the Lord in splendor and in holiness. David is caught up beyond the clouds and the thunder and the lightning to almost see that, wow, in heaven, they are crying out, holy, holy, holy. The glory of the Lord is being lifted up. At verse 3, he says, the voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The word water here is seas, and the Jews were not a seafaring people. They hated the ocean. It represented chaos. In fact, the word for ocean is the word for chaos in the earliest Hebrew. That it was chaos. That's where the Philistines came from. They had ships. They came and attacked us. We're going to stay to the land. And so this sense of over the waters is crazy. When Jesus stills the storm It speaks to a Jewish way of thinking. The waters are the chaos of life. The waters are the struggles. And Jesus, by stilling it, is over the waters. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of God thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. What is he saying? In all the places of chaos, God's glory trumps all things. God's glory remains. The voice of the Lord is over the chaos. We've been living in a chaotic world. How many of you have decision fatigue? I just don't want to make one more decision. I don't want to decide, are we masking or not masking? I don't care. Are we walking? Are we doing? I don't care. You know, it's a great time for my team to come to me and ask for things, because I'm like, I don't care. Can we completely redecorate the sanctuary? I don't care. Can we hire a new senior pastor? I don't care. I just don't want to choose. And we've all been through the chaos, so the chaos causes you to have to try to figure it out every moment. You're sailing in a storm, you got to watch the winds, you got to bring it around bit by bit by bit all the time. And I just want to declare to you what the Lord declares to us in his word. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. Then David says this, the voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. One of the best places to be in a storm is indoors. You ever been in one of those torrential downpours where you're in your house or somebody's and you kind of want to get out to the front porch where you're kind of covered, but you watch the water pour off the gutters and the downspouts fill and the waters rush down the streets. You almost want to be close, but dry. You want to get there. Well, David is having that feeling. It's like, oh, Lord, you are so powerful. Lord, you are so majestic. I want to ask you a very simple question. Do you believe that our God is powerful? If so, say amen.
Amen.
Do you believe that our God is majestic? If so, say amen.
Amen.
Okay, I just want you to hold that in this storm. We stand on the porch, some sheltered, and we are awed at the power. Anytime you think that we are in control as humanity, go stand out in a rainstorm. You know, in Colorado, we have weather people who get paid a lot of money for doing absolutely nothing because nobody knows what it's going to be. And yet, the Lord is there, and we can't change the weather or stop it. Verse 5 of Psalm 29. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon leap like a calf, Syrian like a young ox. Well, what's that all about? Well, scholars believe that Psalm 29 is one of the very first songs that David writes, because he uses Canaanite words. And in fact, Syrian is one of the mountains in the north of Israel in the Canaanite world. And so he's using this picture of Mount Hermon in a name of chaos, Syrian. And he says, the voice of the Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon, the big ones, the sequoias of that area of the world. They can't stand. They are crushed before the glory of the Lord. He breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon, and he makes Lebanon leap like a calf, Mount Hermon, Syrian like a young ox. It's like he makes the mountains dance, shake, move in every direction. This is how powerful God is. Nothing limits him. There is nothing that can't be moved by him, nothing that can't be shaken. Even the rock of this mountain that we look to in Palestine all the time, it dances like a calf. Why? Because the power of the Lord is that big. Verse 7, the voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forest bare. Do you hear the power? Do you hear the storm? And the response at the end of verse 9, and all in his temple cry, glory. Glory. My brothers and sisters, it is so easy to get caught up in the little nuances of our problems, the little phraseologies of this, or the little parsings of that, or the little wishes of that, or the little desires of that. The glory of the Lord is so heavy, so thick, so great, that in heaven they just cry out, glory, glory. How I wish I was more filled with that voice of heaven. That when I come to a problem or an issue or a struggle, I don't try to figure out, how am I going to do this? How can I work this out? We're really responsible for this. I'm really good. No, no, no. I'm the guy with the ripped pants. Why do I think that I have to be the problem solver of my church? Why do I think that I have to be the one who's going to fix my session? Because they think they have to fix me. It's only fair, right? No, no, why do we feel like it's all our responsibility? I want to tell you, the Lord is in charge of all things. And maybe if we would just stop arguing about silly stuff and just cry, glory, glory, then the Lord would move upon the earth in a spectacular way. 29:10, the Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as king forever. It's a regal picture. The waters seem out of control. The flood has moved in. The wave has come. The struggles are here. The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. He is enthroned as king forever. Did you get that in the first 10 verses of this psalm, there's no comment about people? There's not really much need for him to talk about us. But David, at the end of his glory fest on God, ends with a simple line. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. It's almost an afterthought. Huh, the glory of the Lord. Oh, my goodness, the storm. But the Lord hasn't forgotten us. And what does he give us? Strength. Strength for turbulent times. And shalom, that deep, abiding peace. And it flows out of God's glory. It's not like, well, let's find peace and then God will be glorified. Oh, my brothers and sisters, we got it backwards. God is glory. We don't have to figure it out. It's true. We just have to declare it to the nations. We just have to declare it to the nations. I've been up on Long's Peak when the storm is hitting. Usually you see it rolling in maybe 40 minutes beforehand. You try to climb it in the morning so you're down before the afternoon storms come in. But if you're up there, what you really do is you go, okay, guys, everybody touch the top of the mountain. Okay, now we're going down. We're not staying up here. Don't look around. We're going down. What are we going to do? The storm's coming. I said, just trust me. And you go down just a little ways off the top, and this is what you find. Someone has built a stone hut right down from the top of the mountain. It's called the keyhole hut. Doesn't have windows, no television, no beds, just stone benches. But it has one thing, a lightning rod. And it's down enough that if you can get into the rock, it rains like crazy outside. It storms around you like you can't imagine, and your hair still stands on end. But you are safe. The Lord gives His people peace. Maybe I'm pushing the metaphor, but this is the keyhole shelter. This is the place in the rock where we are safe. This is where we run to. The gift of Christ, the new covenant, His blood. Lord, Your glory is great. Thank You that You shelter us in Your arms and watch over us. Thank You that You give us peace and strength. I give to You what was given to me, that on the night Jesus was betrayed, He took the bread and after giving thanks, maybe He did a Jewish Shabbat prayer, maybe He did a Seder prayer. Sometimes I think He just said, God, Your glory is great. And after giving thanks, He took the bread and He broke it. An object lesson. This is My body, broken for you. I'm going to carve out a place in the rock so you'll be able to see the Lord's glory but not be consumed by it. Sounds like Moses, doesn't it? Hide me in the rock that I may see Your back and see Your glory. That's what Jesus does with His body broken for us. In a similar way, after supper, He took the cup and He said, this cup is the new covenant in My blood. The Jeremiah covenant written on our hearts, not on tablets of stone. The covenant of God's mercy, not the law. This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Whenever you drink this, remember Me. It's almost as if Jesus knows that we forget that our pants are ripped. And yet, Jesus knows if He doesn't cover us, we will never be covered. Let's pray. Lord, would You take this bread and this juice and this stupid cup thing, and would You transform it from a common everyday thing to a holy vessel? That somehow in faith, as we come to You and remember what You have done for us, declaring Your glory to everybody we see, to every nation, Lord, may we be reminded of how much You have covered us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would open the bread side, please. I say, take and eat and remember. Open up the juice side. My brothers and sisters, do you believe that the mercies of the Lord are new every morning? So say amen. Amen. Then I give you the new covenant of his mercy. I don't care how bad the storm is in your life. Run to Jesus and you shall be safe. Take, drink, remember. I know that some of you have those fancy cars that give you miles to empty, where you can figure out how far you can go and you watch it get down. And I can drive with it about one or two miles left and doesn't bother me at all. Makes my wife crazy. She feels like I'm going to abandon her, you know, in some dark alley someplace. We're going to run out of gas. I've actually tried to see how far beyond zero I can go. Just to see, I know there's still gas in there. It says zero. It's lying to me because the motor's running. I wonder how far I can go. I've gotten to 19 miles past zero. And then I was a little nervous by then, so I got gas. Some of you guys are at zero or at one. Some of you guys have been at zero for a while, and you're just trying to figure out how far you're going to get to go before it all ends. My brothers and sisters, I want you to come and be prayed for if you want to. And I promise you, the Lord is sufficient. The Lord is good. The Lord has a spiritual gas station you cannot believe. You know what the name of it is? Glory. Come on up if you'd like some prayer. I'll invite the moderators to come forward. Our spouses, any of those else that we've asked you to lead in prayer. And I just want to give you a chance to come forward and ask for prayer if you want to. And if not, while you're sitting in your seat, would you begin to ask the Lord, who should I be praying for? What do you want from me right now, Lord? How do I get this zero off my gauge? How do I not run out?